Good morning. We're glad you could join us this morning as we come to worship together in the name of Jesus Christ. It's a hot one here today, and I tell you what, I'm sitting here sweating already because I got a hot sermon for you today. So if you see me sweating while I'm preaching, you know that I'm doing it out of encouragement for you and encouragement for your family, because it's warm today. It's warm here inside the church. Even though we have an air conditioner going, it's still warm. But I encourage you today to stay with us.
Staring at a stop sign, watching people drive by, T-Mac on the so much on your mind, nothing's really going right, looking for a ray of hope. Whatever it is you may be going through, I know it's not gonna let it get the best of you. You're an overcomer, stay in the fight too.
Are you a discourager or are you an encourager? Before we go away, I do want to let you know that I did check on Miss Prince this week, and she is home and she is doing better. She can't have visitors, but she is home, and Brother Jay had some surgery this week also. He's home and doing well, and we sure should have some others that are out there, but that's all that I have been told about. I do know that we have some birthdays that are coming up a little bit later this month. So if you have anything that needs to be announced, Let us know so that we can put it out there.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Buried deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to Him I give, ever to Him I'll cling. In His blessed presence live, ever His praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best songs. Faithful, loving service to Him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
my feeble life is old. You know, time for me will be no more. Oh, guide me safely, gently, oh, to thy kingdom, to thy shore, to thy shore. Everybody sing with us. Oh, just a closer walk with thee.
Just a closer walk. Just a closer walk.
Granted, Jesus is my plea. Oh, daily walking close to. Come on, one more time.
Just
a closer walk with thee.
Just a closer walk.
Oh, granted, Jesus is my plea.
So let's pray before we begin service today. Lord, I thank you for those that have tuned in. We thank you that you allow us to come and worship you. And Lord, I encourage those that are watching to invite others to come and watch it with them, to be a part of it, to sing along with the music, to give you the praise and to give you the honor, because we have come at this time to worship you. For us in Jesus' name, amen. Good morning. If you will, if you'll go ahead and turn in your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I want to talk to you today about, are you a discourager or are you an encourager? You know, today we've got many, many people that are discouragers. You don't have to go far, and there are discouragers all around us. You know, for many years, I have said that when I retire, that I plan to ride my motorcycle from my house all the way up to the Arctic Circle in Alaska, in Prudhoe Bay, Alaska. And pretty much everybody has given me discouraging words, telling me, you really going to do that? Do you really know what you're getting into? And I've done a pretty good bit of research on it and everything, and I plan on, you know, when I'm doing it, to be able to do it, maybe take a month or so to, you know, doing it. They put out a book every year that's called The Mile Post, and it tells you all the places that are closed and opened and where the roads are good and bad and the points of interest that you might want to stop at. But pretty much all I've had, pretty much has been discouragers. I really haven't had very many people that are encouraging me to do this, because it's a pretty good ride up there. And so, you know, we need to look at it. Are we encouragers or discouragers? In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, let me read this to you, you can follow along. So now, brothers, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you, for you know very well the day of the Lord.
You know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly, as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers, are not in the darkness, so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are the sons of the light and sons of the day. We do not belong to the night and the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be self-controlled and put the thing on faith and love as of the best breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now I want you to really pay attention to this last verse. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Let us pray. Lord God and Father, we thank you for this day that we can come together and worship with you. Though it may not be together within the walls of your church, Lord, we come together and worship through internet, television, radio, many ways that you give us, Lord. And we thank you for giving us those abilities to be able to do that. And Lord, I pray that as we go through this time today, that it will be you that they hear and not me. For we give you the honor and the glory for us in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a book which I read. It's called Growing Deep in the Christian Life. And there's a great story explaining how we face opposition. It tells about a man who was ready to go on a voyage that he had dreamed about doing all his life. He built his own boat. It was a small boat, but he built his own small, tiny boat. And without exception, pretty much everyone, except for very few, discouraged him and said, "You can't do it. You can't last that long." The day came for him to go do it, and he went to launch the boat beside a pier. And as he was launching the boat beside the pier, pretty much everybody on the pier were hollering discouraging words to him. "Are you crazy? You're not going to make it. Your boat's going to sink. You don't have enough food. The weather's going to be bad. You're going to get lonely. You're going to go crazy." You know, and just on and on. Your boat's not going to be able to withstand the storms. And this one man was standing back on the shore, and he saw what was happening. And he didn't know the guy. He didn't know what it was all about. But he went on and ran out to the end of the pier. And when he ran out to the end of the pier, he started waving his hands and says, "Bon voyage, bon voyage. Have a great trip. We're proud of you. Go do a good job, my man. Bon voyage." And he went off into the distance. You see, the man was standing nearby, and the words of encouragement outweighed the words of discouragement. So many times, we decide to, instead of giving words of encouragement, we give words of discouragement. You know, as the little boat pulled away from the pier, all he could remember hearing was the man telling them good luck. Words of encouragement. In a sense, all of us are in a little boat. A little boat we call life. And we're on a long journey, and not knowing where it's going to take us. I mean, we don't know what's going to happen in an hour and a half from now. We think we know, but we don't know. We don't know what's going to happen in a day. We can plan, but it might not go that way. And as we push out into our lives, you know, a few people stand there giving us encouragement. Most are only critical and negative, giving us discouragement. I mean, after all, it doesn't take long to see the discouragement when you turn on the television. You turn on the television and the news is constantly full of discouragement. Very little encouragement. I mean, right now we hear about the COVID and how it's still going up and you know, how the in politics they're not getting along, things are not happening. I can tell you now there's a whole lot more encouraging things that are happening in this world, but all we see in the news basically is discouragement. You know, that's pretty sad commentary for life, though, isn't it? Because often it's very true for most of us that there are many discouragers in our life, but very few encouragers. Think about it. How many people do you have in your life that are really encouragers in comparison to how many you have in your life that are discouragers? Well, we live in a world where people are finding themselves being put down, rejected and held back in so many ways. It's easy to laugh at men's ideals. You know, it's easy for people to laugh that, you know what, that guy's going with that little bitty boat across the ocean. He must have lost his mind. It's easy for people to laugh, you know, that I have the ideal that I'd like to ride my motorcycle all the way up to the Antarctic Circle. It's easy to pour cold water on other people when they have enthusiasm about something, because that's the easy way to do it. Instead of encouraging them and finding a way that they can do it. And it's so easy just to discourage others. One of the church's ministries is encouragement. Sometimes we forget about that. We have a Christian duty to encourage one another. We, many times, a word of praise or thanks or appreciation or cheer has kept a man on his feet. I mean, I'm going to tell you right now, it's easy to sit there and discourage someone and knock them down and find fault in what they're doing. But when you can sit there and give somebody just a little bit of an encouraging word, stand there beside them, with them, man, that's can do wonders. The power of encouragement, 1 Thessalonians 5, 9 says, therefore encourage one another and build each other up, just in fact as you are doing. You see, but also reckless words pierce like a sword, but the tongue of the wise brings healing. You know, Mark Twain said, I can live for 2 months on one good compliment. Think about that. When was the last time you gave somebody a compliment? I mean a true, sincere compliment. I was at work one day this week, and there was a young man that got up and had to give a safety presentation. And he really did a good job. And I was really proud of him for what he did. And I called him to my office the next day and I said, let me tell you one thing right now. You did a great job and I encourage you to keep doing what you're doing. I said, there's going to be one day when I'm going to have to retire and I want you to make sure that you keep carrying the ball. I wanted to give him that word of encouragement and let him know he did the right thing. For every critical comment we receive, it takes 9 affirming comments to even out the negative effect in our life, according to Jim Burns. I want to tell you, one compliment can just do so much for somebody to help them, to take them over the edge, whereas all these other negative comments are coming in. It's like, you know, you get on Facebook and you see all these negative comments that people are talking about this and that. Now, how much encouragement are you seeing there? You see, a greatest great example of how encouragement made a difference, you know, in someone's life was on May the 24th, 1965, a 13 and a half foot boat slipped quietly out of the marina in Falmouth, Massachusetts. Its destination was England. It would be the smallest boat to ever make the trip. Its name was Tinkerbell. And its pilot was Robert Maneri. He had been a copy editor for the Cleveland Plain Dealer for 10 years and was bored. So he took a leave of absence to fulfill his secret dream. Robert Maneri was afraid, though, that not of the ocean. He was afraid of all those who would try to talk him out of it, talk him out of making this trip. So he didn't tell many people, just a few relatives and his wife. His wife, Virginia, was his greatest supporter and encourager in his endeavor. The trip was anything but pleasant. He spent many sleepless nights trying to cross the shipping lanes without getting run down and sunk. Weeks at sea caused his food to become tasteless. Loneliness caused him to have hallucinations. His rudder broke three times and he had to fix it. Storms swept him overboard numerous times, and if he had not had a rope and tied it around his waist, he would never have made it back on board. Finally, after 78 days alone at sea, he sailed into Falmouth, England. During his many nights, he fantasized about what he would do once he arrived in England. He expected simply to check into a hotel, go eat dinner alone, and then the next morning, see if the Associated Press might be interested in his story. But word of his approach had spread far and wide to his amazement. And 300 vessels, with their horns blasting, escorted Tinkerbell into the port. And 40,000 people stood screaming and cheering him on to the shore. Robert Maneri had become a hero overnight. And his story has been told around the world, but Robert Maneri couldn't have done it alone. You see, standing on the dock was even a greater hero, his wife, Virginia. She had refused to be critical and negative about her husband's trip. You see, she was there, standing there. She gave him constant encouragement, which enabled him to pursue and complete his dream. You see, the world needs a whole lot more people just like Virginia Maneri, both men and women alike, who will give others the needed encouragement for life's obstacles. Because we all have obstacles. We all have go through discouragements. I mean, there's no one exempt from it. Consider the role of an encourager in church history. A great encourager in the Word of God was Paul, especially when it came concerning Timothy. Paul had accepted by the early church because of a greater encourager, Barnabas. When Barnabas arrived and saw the proof of God's favor, he was filled with joy. He encouraged the believers to stay true. Stay true to the Lord. Barnabas was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and strong in faith. And large numbers of people were brought to the Lord because of Barnabas. You know, are you being a Barnabas? And what do you really know about Barnabas? Well, if you look in Acts chapter 4, verses 34 through 37, let me read to you. And it tells us that Barnabas had a mild and gentle disposition. Barnabas' life was a mode of encouragement for every Christian. Barnabas was rightly called the son of encouragement because he knew how to inspire people toward greatness. Barnabas possessed land. He generously disposed of it for the benefit of the Christian community and laid the money at the apostles' feet. Yeah. As this transaction occurred soon after the day of Pentecost, he must have been an early convert in Christianity. But Barnabas was an encourager. I challenge you to be an encourager and not a discourager. The spiritual lessons from Barnabas is that there's one in every crowd that can be an encourager. Barnabas was known and loved in Jerusalem. I mean, he was called the son of encouragement. He used the full spirit that the gift had given, God had given him as a gift to encourage others spiritually. Sometimes the greatest blessing of one believer can give another is to give him or her the benefit of the doubt. So many times we forget to give others the benefit of the doubt. We go into the discouragement mode, the attack mode. You see, Barnabas stood beside Paul. Barnabas stood beside John Mark. Barnabas encouraged the local church. Faithfulness, like charity, begins at home. And after Barnabas had proven himself in his own home church, God used him in many, many churches. You see, he was an encourager. The church will never have a shortage of people who will want to be its Pauls and discouragers. But we need to have more encouragers. Are you willing to be the Barnabas, the encourager? So how to be an encourager? People will only allow themselves to be helped when they know that we love them and encourage them. You see, you're not going to open up your door for somebody that doesn't love you and really is watching out for you. You will open your door to somebody that encourages you. You're not going to open your door when you see that person that cuts you down, is always talking about you behind your back and trying to belittle what you're trying to do. No, you're going to open your doors to the person that encourages you and tries to help lift you up when you have fallen and stumbled. That's what we need to be. We need to touch them and comfort them and assure them. My question today for you is, are you encouraging anyone? Are you making anyone comfortable in their life when they need comfort? When they need the assurance of someone because they don't know what to do? Are you doing that? You see, we got all kind of things going on in this world today that we need all kind of people encouraging people in the right direction. We got all kind of people that are discouraging people going the wrong direction, and we don't have very many encouragers in the right direction. We need to be brightening their lives with unconditional love and grace and blessings. You see, it doesn't matter the color of a person's skin or what language they speak. The language of love goes across whatever it is. The language of encouragement goes across. You see, God expects us to share our abundance with those who have less. The poor, the orphans, the widows. All this is symbolic of many of who have less than we have and need our help. Who is it that you know today that needs your help? Who is it that you know that you need to go and encourage to get closer to Jesus Christ? Who is it that you know that you need to encourage to be in church? Who is it that you need to encourage if they won't come to church? sit down and listen with, to you to these broadcasts that we are doing in these sermons? Who is it that you can encourage in their life? I will guarantee you will not have to look far. There's probably somebody within your immediate family that needs this encouragement. This might be your next door neighbor that needs encouragement. Might be your best friend that needs encouragement. And it might be you that needs encouragement, and you just don't know who to go ask for encouragement. You can call me. I'll be glad to talk to you. And maybe there will be some way that I can, if nothing else, I can pray with you and encourage you that the Lord, whatever your problem is, He can handle it. It might not be in the way that you want Him to handle it. And He might handle it faster than you're ready for Him to handle it. But He can handle it. There's no problem too big for Him. You see, today I want you to be ready to turn your life over to Him. Turn your problems over to Him. If you're scared to go encourage someone, don't do it in your own strength. Ask the Holy Spirit to go with you when you go to encourage them. Because today, in this time, in this day, we have a lack of encouragement going on in this world. There's too many things that Satan is using to discourage us. I want you to step up and be that encourager. Let's pray. Lord God, our Father, we thank you for those that you have sent before us, the Barnabas in our lives that have encouraged us, and help us to be a Barnabas for others. Lord, help us to be an encourager and not a discourager. Help us to lead others in the way that you would have us to lead them. And Lord, I pray that if there's anyone that's watching here this morning that doesn't know you, I encourage them to turn their lives over to you so that they can be a brother or sister in Christ also, that they can depend on you because you are the one that's in control. You are the great encourager. You encouraged us by sending your Son, Jesus Christ, who came and died for us in our sins. You encourage us with your Holy Spirit. You encourage us with your word that you have given us. And Lord, we thank you for that. We give you the honor and we give you the glory for us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sitting at the stoplight, you can't be bothered by the heart cry written on the cardboard in her hand. Oh, but when she looks him in the eye, his heart is broken open wide, and he feels the hand of God reach out through him. As heaven touches her, but he's not able for all the shame that's locked in deep inside. Oh, but her words are the medicine when she says they can begin again, and forgiveness will set him free tonight. As heaven touches her, oh, 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 we bring the kingdom come. One of those doors is you. I said God put a million, million doors in the world for his love to walk through.
through. One of those doors is you.
Encourager in Jesus Christ. Have a great week.